Okay, looks like it's 6:30. So I would like to convene this meeting of the Board of Directors of the San Lorenzo Valley Water District on March 4th. Can we have the roll call, please?
President Mayhood?
Here.
Vice President Henry?
Here.
Director Fulf?
Here.
Director Smalley?
Here.
And Director Tu?
Here.
Thank you.
Are there any additions or deletions to the agenda?
Staff has none.
I have one.
Okay, Director Smalley.
Yes, the City of Santa Cruz recently submitted a petition to the state's Water Resources Control Board to change their water rights permits as they apply to withdrawing water from the San Lorenzo River. I'm aware that Rick Rogers and staff have been working to review that and how it might affect the district, but the board and the public have not had the opportunity to understand what the staff concludes. And I'd like to make sure the board and the public have the opportunity to do that and to potentially ask any questions.
Okay. As you know, we can't discuss this in great detail today because it's not on the agenda, and we can agendize it for a future meeting. But our district council, who is a specialist in water rights, maybe you can just give a really brief description of what we've been up to.
Sure. Yeah, but briefly, I can do that, Chair Mayhood. We have been reviewing Santa Cruz's petitions and the notice that came from the State Water Board regarding the potential changes to Santa Cruz's water rights. And we have been meeting with experts to determine whether to file some kind of a response to that notice from the State Water Board. And we hadn't put it on a meeting agenda because we were working on it internally with staff. And I believe the response is due next Friday. So there may not be an opportunity to put it on a regular meeting agenda unless there's a desire perhaps to review. I mean, there's gonna be a long process here, so it could perhaps be agendized for some discussion after that initial response, if any initial response goes in after that initial response is done, while the process is still ongoing before the state board.
That seems reasonable to me, is maybe after you've filed it, we can agendize it for a meeting soon after that, before the Water Board has issued their decision. So Rick and I will work on that. Now's the time for oral communications. And this portion of the agenda is reserved for oral communications by the public on any subject that lies within the jurisdiction of the district but is not on tonight's agenda. And let's see, are there any comments from the public? Let's see here, get my Jim Mosher.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Great. Well, I was really glad to hear Director Smalley bring to the attention of the board and those attending the meeting about the Santa Cruz permit to change their water rights. This is the first time in 100 years, I understand, that they've done that. First time I heard about this was when I read an opinion piece in the Santa Cruz Sentinel by the director of the Santa Cruz Water District saying that they were going to do this. I was surprised, Rosemary Menard, surprised to read it in the paper and not having heard about this, because I knew this could possibly affect our district as well as our watershed. So I really urge the board and the staff to look at this carefully, and hopefully it is a part of a regional plan that will be beneficial to the region and not harmful to our area, but it seems to me we need to look carefully at what this may mean for our ability to draw from Fall Creek, what it means for our allotment with at Loch Lomond and what possible implications it may have for the recharging of the aquifer and for the general well-being of the watershed. It surprises me that this isn't been discussed either here or at the Santa Margarita Groundwater Agency. Maybe it has been and I just missed it. But it just struck me as, wow, this is kind of a major thing. And I don't understand the implications of the fact that protests have to be filed by March 12th. It sounds like from what Attorney Nichols said that perhaps there'll be other opportunities to influence the decision, even if we don't file a protest. But it seems like that's something that the board would want to take a careful look at to make sure that we're not losing some opportunity to be engaged in the process by letting that deadline go by without filing something. I also thought this might be something we could talk to the Scotts Valley Water District about, since this could potentially have an impact on them. Maybe this is something we could be collaborating on. Thank you.
Thank you. Larry Ford.
Thank you. This is Larry Ford. Wow, I too was surprised that this, when this issue came up, in reading the Santa Cruz Sentinels, I do every day. And I'm very concerned about the potential impacts of this move by the city of Santa Cruz on our ability to use Fall Creek water and to use the Loch Lomond water. Certainly, I don't understand all the different dimensions of it. So just hearing some discussion from Jim Mosier is very interesting. And I wonder what else you know, Director Smalley. But I think it sounds like a really good idea to have some kind of a special meeting. And also, I'm really pleased to hear that the staff was already aware of this and that you guys are working on this. It's all been with such short notice. So that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Are there any more comments from the public? If not, Director Fultz.
Yes, can we schedule a special meeting on that for next week before the filing?
How about if Rick and I talk about that tomorrow and we'll see if that's a possibility and can get back to you?
Yeah, I mean, I was aware that this was going on. I don't know that we had been informed there was a filing coming up shortly. But I think it would be worthwhile for the board and the public to have a discussion about that before we put the filing in.
Okay, thank you. So I'll check in with Rick about that. And Gina too, because she needs to be there for that. All right, we'll go on for unfinished business. And the first item is the loan that we're planning to take out. District Manager Rogers.
Yes, thank you, Chair Mayhood. We'll ask the finance manager to present this item to the board.
Stephanie, are you there?
Can you hear me now?
Yes, we can now.
Okay, perfect. So this is essentially from a lot of the discussions that we had before, all of the paperwork on the installment purchase agreement that go into all of this. Is now where we are at and ready for the board to hopefully adopt. This is the $15 million loan through CoBank, secured for 20 years at a 2.4 interest rate. This is covering about $9 million worth of the CZU fires and then another $6 million of other pipeline and a tank project. We do have bond counsel on the phone if anyone has specific questions about the installment purchase agreement. But otherwise, you know, this is kind of just the culmination of the discussions that we've been having in the past.
Okay. Is there any discussion among the board? And Director Smalley?
Yes, I have a few questions on it. The loan has a number of conditions and requires a project fund in section 3.10 and also requires financial statements and audits. Are the statements and audits anything beyond what we typically do? And are we prepared to set up that project fund as required with all the necessary details?
So we do have the project fund ready and set up. This money is going to be held similar to our $14 million COP at an account at the county that is separate, and then we'll draw down on it as we, you know, are paying the expenditures for these projects. The other loans do require us to submit our annual financial report within a certain time frame that, you know, always is in time for us to have it prepared. This loan does require a little bit more quarterly reporting. A lot of what we do now, you know, what I present now in our quarterly financials is what they need. They do need, even though it's a high level, they do need a balance sheet aspect of it. And so we are going to be integrating that into our quarterly reports. And so it shouldn't be too much of a lift. You know, we'll do our quarterly reports a little bit more robust and then send it off to them each quarter.
Okay. And one other question that I have. The section 4.6 system maintenance refers to maintenance that the loan expects us to be able to do on any of the systems that are being installed. Do we have a preventive maintenance schedule with all of our other equipment? And is this then something that we just add to? And it also, that section also requires anticipated costs for any of this maintenance. So do we have this preventive maintenance schedule with costs for existing to expand on?
Rick may be able to answer that in a little bit more detail.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a kind of a two-part answer here. We do have a computerized maintenance management schedule. Now, we have not funded all of this maintenance over the past year, such as tank coatings would be one that comes that we're trying to catch up. System maintenance, you know, such as the vehicles are in the computerized maintenance management program. But, you know, we're up on vehicle maintenance, but district-wide, it's hit and miss at this point in time. We do monitor it. We do have a mechanism for it, but a lot of it is not funded at this point.
Okay. It sounds to me like though, for the monies from this loan, it's going to require something a bit more rigorous than as to maintenance.
That's correct. And you know, the main lines, the maintenance is minimal. Now the tank, the Blue Ridge tank will require either coatings or and a maintenance schedule for protection. We are built in the RFP for the tank replacement. We'll have the first annual maintenance built in to the bid, and hopefully we will get on track on tank maintenance. That's one of our first priorities, and we're already scheduling tank maintenance coming up in this current budget process that we're moving ahead on the two-year budget process.
Okay, all right, thank you. That's all of my questions.
Director Fultz?
Yes, I have a few questions, not particularly difficult, hopefully. On page 15 of 52, the definition of revenues, are we talking about total revenues or operating revenues? It wasn't clear to me exactly what the definition was covering.
It is net revenues, so it's gross revenues less operating revenues.
Well, by total revenues, what I'm referring to is non-operating revenues like property taxes, for example? Does it include that?
No, it's just from the water system revenues.
Okay, great.
Yeah, and it's the same pledge that was in your prior financing.
Next one is, what's our new forecasted debt coverage ratio after we take this loan down? Where do we end up?
Oh, I had that at one point. I don't have that up in front of me, but I can send it to you. It still is very healthy. I mean, we essentially would have been able to take out a loan, double this.
Yeah.
I do believe we're still around, I think we'll be around the 2.5 once this, we're about to have that Bank of Nevada loan that matures September of this year.
Yeah.
So it takes a little bit of a dip since we have that concurrent, but next year, I believe it was, you know, we were still in that 2.5 range.
Okay, yeah, because, I mean, 12 to 18 months from now, we need to be looking at another one, in my opinion. Okay, section 6.2, just a small typo, there's a reference to prepayment premium identified in section 6.2, I think it was meant 6.3. And on that, on the prepayment premium, could you guys expand on that a little bit? What's our effective prepayment possibility? Is there any prepayment possibility we could really take advantage of without paying a huge penalty?
So essentially, we secured the lower rate. Some of the other options had it built into where you could do a prepayment at year 7 or year 10.
Yep.
We took the yield maintenance provision, which means we can pay this off at any point if the rates are higher. If the rates are lower and we're looking to pay it off, there is a calculation that will occur for whatever the current going rate is, the differential. You know, there's a portion that we would have that option. And obviously, if the rates were severely lower than, you know, the 2.4, we'd be weighing, you know, what the cost is versus what the potential savings would be of a refinance.
It's a severe penalty basically for doing it if it's under, so we probably don't want to. The good news is that, you know, we aren't paying that much interest on this overall. And then the last one might be for Rick. Hang on here. Rick, in the table there, where does the non-fire recovery start? Make sure the public is aware of that.
I don't have that table up in front.
Is it the South Zone distribution system piping?
Are you talking about Exhibit A in the project description?
Yeah, A1. Yeah, Exhibit A, right.
Right. Okay, The descriptions for the non-fire are the projects of the Orman Road water main replacement, the Fernwood main replacement, the Juanita Woods water main replacement, the Ziani Drive water main replacement, and the Blue Ridge tank project replacement.
Great. And is that sort of the order of priority that you're thinking we would do?
Well, you know, pretty much so, but seeing, you know, we have a short construction window to complete these projects. So, you know, the first year we'll be going out in design, plan specifications, CEQA review, and then the second, third year we'll be in construction, and we plan to be simultaneously moving ahead on these projects. Some will go maybe a little sooner than other. I would say the long lead item project on this that might come in right at the tail end would be the Blue Ridge tank.
Blue Ridge, yeah. Yeah, tanks are always fun.
Tanks are a little more problematic. Right. And maybe could we get Stephanie to introduce, I have a horrible time pronouncing your name, is it Morel? Because I'm not sure the board and everybody knows her.
Yes, we have Murnal Shaw from BBK Law, who has been our bond counsel, on the phone. She was the one that created this massive document, so she is very, very well versed in documents and, you know, loans of this such.
No, that's pretty much the question. I just wanted to make sure that the community knew which projects were not part of the fire related.
And fire recovery we're already working on the next list of projects through what's been identified in our water master plan to move ahead for our next round of loan money, as you spoke of. We're already
pedal to the metal, Rick.
Yeah.
All right. Great. Thank you.
Director Tu, do you have anything you want to ask?
Nope. Thank you.
Okay. Director Henry?
I read all of that, and I did have a question, but I know the answer, and so I don't have a question now.
Okay. We have a resolution before us. Can I move that and then go out to public comment?
Yeah, I'll have a statement when we come back.
Of course. What is the number on the resolution?
Chair Mayhood, it is blank so that it can be filled in with the next available number.
I have that number.
Right. So, okay, well, let's go out to the let's go out to the public and see if any of the public have a comment on the agenda item in front of us. And I don't see any. So we can
go. Yep. You should check with the caller. There's a caller.
Okay, there is one caller here. I don't know if they have a way. Why don't you unmute the caller? And caller, if you'd like to make a comment, please go ahead and do so. And appears like not. So, okay, we'll go back to the board, and I'm going to go ahead and move the resolution and read it out. It's resolution number to be determined. A resolution of the San Lorenzo Valley Water District approving an installment purchase agreement with respect to financing improvements to the water system in an amount not to exceed $15 million and other matters pertaining thereto.
Second.
Thank you. Do we have any comments or further comments? Okay, Director Fultz.
Yes, due to the CZU fire, the district is facing significant replacement activities, which will result in additional costs to the district. Even with the FEMA reimbursement, which is anticipated to be 75% of the allowed replacement costs. While our estimate for construction costs is currently $20 million, meaning our contribution would be $5 million, past experience indicates that actual construction costs, particularly during disaster recovery periods, will likely be much higher. So while the original proposal was for the district to borrow $5 million, and this is the reason in my mind for the change, the last thing I want our district to have to do is go back to financing agencies for more money at a time when that money is more urgently needed. It's at that point that negotiating leverage shifts to the lender and the deal isn't as good. In addition, the district has effectively exhausted its $3 million in reserves due to costs resulting from the emergency work required to restore service after the fire. The methods available to us to replenish these reserves will take time. It would be irresponsible of this board to not take steps to ensure sufficient funds are available for potential future disasters, given that we live in an earthquake, a heavy rain, and now fire-prone zone. In other words, given we're going into yet another fire season, and maybe we didn't leave the last one, waiting for a slow buildup of funds to replenish reserves is not prudent. Finally, there is still a discussion to be had about the method by which we're going to replace the raw water lines from our supply creeks in Ben Lomond Mountain and what FEMA would cover on that. The path of least resistance, and the only one FEMA may fund, is to replace the above ground plastic pipe and wooden supports that burned with above ground plastic pipe and wooden supports that can burn again in a future fire. Should we as a community decide we wish to further harden our raw water supply lines and FEMA will not participate in that, then our community would be on the hook for 100% of those additional costs. We will be having that discussion shortly. On the plus side, it is possible we will get more than the anticipated reimbursement from FEMA and possibly from the state, but again, it would be imprudent to plan based on hopes and wishes. So with all of these uncertainties, type of construction, actual costs, FEMA reimbursement levels, state participation, it was my judgment, I believe the judgment of the board, the fiscal prudence requires we borrow more than the minimum forecasted amount. This $15 million gives us more flexibility and more resilience to respond to the CZU disaster recovery. Yes, we will end up paying more in interest going this route, a bit more. The good news is part of those interest charges will be offset by earning interest on the unused portion. And remember that a focus for this district since 2018 has been on infrastructure. So if any funds remaining after the CZU recovery, those projects identified by Rick Rogers and James Furtado will be applied to that. Given our current interest rates, I think it's staggering to note that we're only paying $4 million in interest over 20 years or $200,000 a year. I would have liked to take down more to continue catching up on decades of much needed infrastructure improvements. Unfortunately, due to the virus, the fire and not having an engineering manager replacement until recently, though we knew how now have one, we're a little behind. However, I hope the district will be looking to take down another loan in another 12 to 18 months or so. As you can see from the list, there are projects that are not part of the CZU recovery. In the meantime, our board owes our community full disclosure of our true financial position, meaning the capital obligations or money associated with decades of deferred maintenance and infrastructure replacement that are now coming due, obligations to current and former employees, necessary reserve levels for disaster resiliency, and going forward, the capital requirements for our district to maintain and improve infrastructure. In addition, the board owes our community complete transparency about why our operating costs have skyrocketed in recent years, which results in keeping our district on the hamster wheel with respect to paying down our capital obligations. The money we have for capital obligations is what is left over after we deduct operating expenses from our revenue. The faster operating expenses rise, and they've risen almost 90% in the last 10 years, the less money is available for the millions of dollars, maybe as high as the low tens of millions of dollars in capital obligations that we're facing. Thank you.
Do any other board members have a comment?
I really don't want to say what my comment is.
Thank you, Lois. I think it's implied. Okay, we have a motion on the table and a second. So can we go ahead and take the vote, please?
Director Mayhood?
Aye.
President Henry?
Aye.
Vice President Henry?
Aye.
Director Paul?
Yes.
Director Smalley?
Yes.
And Director Tu?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Okay, thank you. Next is under unfinished business is exploration of possible consolidation of San Lorenzo Valley Water District with Scotts Valley Water District. District Manager Rogers?
Yes, thank you, Chair Mayhood. This memorandum outlines staff's recommendations to take initial steps needed to explore whether or not to initiate a consolidation between the San Lorenzo Valley Water District and the Scotts Valley Water District. This is not a recommendation to approve a consolidation, only to initiate a public process to start engaging with the public and gathering information needed to make a decision. Nor will there be a request to appropriate, this board to appropriate any funds moving this ahead. It's recommended that the board, SLV board, direct staff to move forward with some initial steps of a lengthy public process to explore potential consolidation between the two districts. Staff recommends that these initial steps include establishing a committee to focus on the issues, including meeting with concerned members of the community and starting to develop information to help the board make a decision. The second part of the recommendation is to hire a consultant to conduct a feasibility study that potential benefits, that do an analysis of potential benefits and pitfalls of a consolidation. Alternatively, the board could take no action tonight and defer any further consideration of this issue to a later date. This alternative is not recommended because it's uncertain if there will continue to be an opportunity for consolidation. A little background: at the February 4th Board of Directors meeting, SLV, the district manager and district council presented an agenda item to the board regarding the possibility of consolidating with Scotts Valley. The staff report suggested there may be substantial benefits if the two agencies could be joined. Additionally, the executive officer of the LAFCO agency was at the meeting and just presented an overview of what a process would look like. The board took no action at this time, preferring to wait to hear the response from the Scotts Valley's board of directors following their consideration of the same item at their upcoming meeting, which was at February 11th. At that meeting, the Scotts Valley board directed its staff to proceed with exploring a possible consolidation contingent upon the San Lorenzo Valley board also deciding to proceed. The recommendation asking tonight would be, given overwhelming support that in public interest, the need for a lengthy public process, including an estimated 2-year timeframe to complete a consolidation, if it goes forward, it would be the formation of an ad hoc or standing committee is recommended. The committee could be tasked to perform a number of important functions, including meeting with concerned members of the community, identifying information needs, gathering information, reviewing documentation, and making reports or recommendations to the full board. The board could appoint directors as members of the ad hoc committee. The structure could be an ad hoc committee tasked for service of a short duration of no more for approximately 6 months, or it could constitute more of a formal or a standing committee intended to serve for a longer duration. A feasibility study, both managers have outlined at a high level the benefits of a possible consolidation. However, in order to more fully understand and vet the anticipated benefits and possible pitfalls, a technical feasibility study is needed. This would involve issuing a request for a proposal to hire a consultant. For reference, the feasibility study for the recent Aptos Central Fire District consolidation was at a cost of $42,000 and change. The board could also defer the consideration. Since the board meeting on February 4th, there has been a considerable response, especially in the communities of the San Lorenzo Valley. There have been several newspaper articles and a great deal of discussion on social media. One of the common questions is being asked, why now? And if this is the right time, as we are in the middle of the COVID-19 pandemic and the starting recovery of the CZU fire. These are definitely valid concerns. However, as I've been quoted, there is never a good time. We are prone for disasters with the different, you know, earthquake, floods, fire. It seems that every couple of years, the San Lorenzo Valley is faced with another ongoing disaster. The current disasters are ongoing, and responding to emergencies is a continuous function of our district, with new emergencies threatening occurring at any time. The consolidation opportunity was introduced at this time with a view towards taking advantage of anticipated retirements of senior staff, which would facilitate a process that would not threaten staff jobs, thereby allowing for the advantageous cooperation between the two agencies. It is uncertain if there will continue to be an opportunity for such a consolidation in the future. That is unknown. In the absence of a definite reason why exploration should not move forward in a manner that is responsive to the needs and concerns of the community, it is recommended to start the process of identifying the questions that need to be answered, gathering the necessary information. In this way, the two districts could continue to work closely together to achieve a better understanding, or whether or not to initiate a formal consideration process in the future. I'm asking the board tonight to consider appointing an ad hoc committee, that the ad hoc committee could be tasked to put together an RFP to bring back to the full board for review for the feasibility study. The feasibility study would then be reviewed by the full board and public and be presented to contractors for bidding. I am not asking the district to appoint any funds tonight. This would be reviewed when the feasibility study were turned into the board for review. With that, I think I'll turn it back over to the board. I think the district needs to evaluate and move forward with this feasibility study so we know what the benefits and pitfalls are. This is a good opportunity to somewhat understand what this process would be. And I ask the board if they have any questions or thoughts from here.
Okay, thank you. Director Henry.
Hey, I have some thoughts on this. I know when I first heard about this, my knee-jerk reaction was no, based on emotion only. And even though I've only been a ratepayer for not quite 5 years, I've been dealing with SLV since March of 2010. So I have quite an attachment to the water district. I really want us to have a feasibility study. I need facts. I don't want just emotion. I want facts. I need to make a decision based on logic and on facts, and to have a committee to do the RFP, to get someone to do a feasibility study, I think would be a great thing. The other thing is, my understanding is that Scotts Valley merges with us. Scotts Valley Water District would no longer exist. It would be San Lorenzo Valley Water District. I don't know if we'd change our name. I like the name the way it is. I kind of wouldn't want that to happen. The other thing is, when's a good time? In the 70s, we had a very wet snow. Millions of trees went down. It was freezing cold, no power for a week. But then in the 80s, 82, 83, 89, I finally said to my husband, I think we need to go back to LA where it's safe. And he gave me this look, as only men can do. Are you nuts? He didn't even respond. It was just a look. So I agree with Rick. There is no good time. There's always something. And I really would like to see this feasibility study done. I believe Scotts Valley wants to merge. And if they don't merge with us, who are they going to merge with? And I have some real concerns about that, who they might merge with if they don't merge with us. They're small, and it's getting hard for small water districts to continue. And it would make SLV larger and stronger. That's all.
Thank you, Director Henry. Director Smalley.
Yes, I have several questions. Rick, you've made the point of recommending that we establish a committee and to hire a consultant. Is it your recommendation that we proceed on both of those concurrently, or would establishing the committee without going out to seek a consultant for this feasibility study be a reasonable first step?
You know, good questions, Mark. I believe we need to do both. I believe that we should establish an ad hoc committee first to put together the RFP and to report to the board on a over the 6 month period monthly at a board of directors public meeting of the progress, and then to bring that RFP back to the full board for review. I think that developing the RFP, it will be a very, very important endeavor, and we should take our time doing that and make sure we incorporate community input as well as the board's input. But I think we need the ad hoc committee to develop the RFP and to go out. So I would say both, but the ad hoc committee first.
Okay. You've said that there's never a good time. However, I think that the restrictions that we're currently under with the pandemic are unusual, the first in 100 years. What do you think we lose if we wait until we're out of this restriction that we're currently under, where we can't meet physically, so that we could have a bit easier of discussions? And by later, I mean, is that October this year? Is that the end of the year? Until the state takes us off of the current restrictions that we're under.
I've thought about this, and I've thought about what the feasibility, the type of staff time and board time, you know, mm-hmm. 6 months of a feasibility study would take. I think it's of the process, I think it's a minor lift. I don't see the pandemic, you know, quite frankly, I see video meetings kind of the wave of the future. It's saving an incredible amount of staff and consultant time. It's curbing costs from travel. I see us probably continuing with a lot of the video conferencing. I went to a meeting for the first time the other day, not to take time, but I actually went to. It was a half hour travel time in one direction. There was two other meetings I had to cancel because of travel time. If I was taking from my office on video, I would have made all three of those meetings. I think the pandemic has changed the way we do business. We'll go back to some of it, but I don't think we'll go back to business as usual. You know, it's the board's decision if they feel that they would like to, you know, wait a while, but I don't see that anything to that would hinder the process or hurt the process.
Okay. we've talked before about water transfers. Transfers from our district to Scotts Valley and from Scotts Valley to us. And I understand that currently we can't do that under emergency conditions. If that was lifted and we had the ability to transfer water, is there a more significant benefit to the merger versus the ability to just do that? And if we have excess at times, if we're selling, if we're gaining a financial benefit from that, since what I see you saying in here is, or what I think I've heard you saying, was the benefit most significant is the financial aspects. So can you comment on that for us?
Well, right now, the only thing that we've really looked into has been the low-hanging fruit. District manager from Scotts Valley and I have discussed, you know, the low-hanging fruit would be, you know, one district manager, one admin mm-hmm. facility. You know, those are the obvious. The feasibility study, I think, would look more in depth into that and could look at the sale of water. We've been talking about the sale of water to Scotts Valley for a long time, before the North-South Intertie was installed. when we looked at the pros and cons of consolidating with the Felton water system. One of the big pros to that is we have a treatment plant located in Felton that we could treat our Loch Lomond water and move it to our south system first, which is, you know, SLV has about 1,000 customers, including the trailer parks in the south system, in the Scotts Valley area, in the Scotts Valley city limits. So we already serve down there, and we've been looking and working on our water rights, because there are a lot of water rights restrictions. There's none on the Loch Lomond water, but there is moving water through the town of Felton, through the point of use. And we've been working on conjunctive use and on working on those water permits now for some time. So I think the feasibility study would tell us, you know, and when we write the RFP, I think it's important that those type of questions for the answers we want are in there. You know, is it the best? Would it just be good for us to take, say, our Loch Lomond water that we don't use and to get that into the basin? You know, as you know, being on Santa Margarita, by getting the Loch Lomond water into the basin, we save money by not having to recharge the basin. Right. So there's a lot of great reasons why we want to get water into that south system, you know, our south system, and potentially into the Scotts Valley water system. So I think the feasibility study, we would definitely want those type of questions answered.
Okay. Last question I have is, how do you anticipate the district being able to do outreach if we were to go ahead with this now under the pandemic restrictions that we're currently still served under, with the outcome of a feasibility study or from this ad hoc committee, other than another Zoom meeting like we're having now?
Well, you know, obviously that's probably our number one, but, you know, you take a look at, since we've brought this to the board, all of the local newspapers have carried this story on their front page for the most part, all the local newspapers, press banner and the bulletin and so forth, social media. And as you look at this call tonight, we have 61 participants. I mean, the word has got out, and I think, you know, with our outreach firms working Scotts Valley, you know, we have an outreach consultant that, you know, gets our post out on Facebook. We have our website. I think the information could get out and would get out. Not could, the information will get out.
Okay, thank you. That's all of my questions.
Okay. Director Tu?
I think a lot of my questions have been asked. Are we gonna potentially use the same feasibility company, or is that something to be discussed later?
We would go with we would put out an RFP that we would request consultants from, you know, all over the state.
Let me be more specific. Would we use the same feasibility contractor to do the study as Scotts Valley in order to potentially save money, or would that be a conflict of interest?
I'm not sure I understand your question, Tina. We would have one, the SLV Water would have one feasibility study to answer those questions. I'm not sure if Scotts Valley would go out and get their own feasibility study, but I doubt it. We would most likely, we would meet with representatives of Scotts Valley. They would review, just like, you know, our board would review, their customers would review, and we would put out one feasibility study with SLV Water in the lead agency.
Okay, and then are they going to help us out with the cost in that?
We have not talked about cost sharing, but we would definitely request the cost sharing.
Okay, that's it. Thank you.
Director Fultz?
I'd like to hear from the public first, and then I may have a few things to say.
Okay, then let's go ahead and go out to the public. You go ahead and raise your hand, we'll call on you. The first person is Leanne Sanders.
Th- Thank you. I am Lee Allen Sanders.
Sorry.
And I'm a ratepayer. Yes. Oh, no worries. I'm a ratepayer in the SLVWD. After closely reading the minutes of previous meetings on this topic, it's clear to me that Rick Rogers could be tagged as a lame duck leader due to upcoming retirement. This means he could be free to make powerfully impactful decisions that will reverberate for many years without fear of consequences. I recommend tabling all activity of any kind regarding this topic until Mr. Rogers' replacement is firmly in power.
Okay. Elaine Fresco.
Hi, I hope this isn't a stupid question, but I am very confused about what the how you choose the members of the ad hoc committee and how they do their research as opposed to the consultant that you would eventually hire.
Rick, would you like to answer her?
I'm not sure I understand her question.
Okay, how are you going to choose the members of your ad hoc committee?
Well,
and what specifically will they be doing? How are they doing their research?
I would leave the selection of the members for the ad hoc committee up to our board of directors. And I would recommend two of our board members be appointed to that committee. And staff would work with the board on putting together an RFP for the feasibility study.
Okay.
And then we would report back monthly to the full board on that progress of moving forward.
Okay. I think we should wait.
Jay Maxwell. Jay Maxwell, you're demuted. You there?
Thank you. I'd like to dovetail on a comment from Director Henry, and she mentioned why does Scotts Valley need to merge? And the observation would be is they're faced with unlimited growth because the city regulates growth, not the water district. They have limited resources in their aquifer. If you look at their budget history from 2015 to 18, where they ran deficit budgets, the only thing that brought them out of deficit budgets was increased connections. And they're running $800,000 a year in projected new connection revenue. And my question is, why is this a benefit to the San Lorenzo Valley Water District if Scotts Valley is running in a deficit mode?
Okay. Beth Thomas?
Thank you. I have a lot of concerns about the timing of this. I wouldn't say that I have a position entirely pro or con the merger, but I'm still waiting to hear what the compelling reason is to initiate this process now as opposed to waiting. I think Director Smalley pointed out some important issues. It seems to me that, you know, we've been recently talking about things like combining committees so that it takes less time for the board and the staff to deal with the issues that we already have to deal with. I've been in several meetings where staff has talked about their inability to take on anything else because, and Director Henry has always supported that, to take on any extra projects or extra work because there isn't enough time. And I can't quite imagine any worse time to take this on, given the fact that we are recovering. We have a huge recovery from the CZU fires, that we are in a time of debris flow danger, and that we're in the midst of a pandemic. And it seems to me that we really, this isn't a normal bad time to do it. This isn't one event. as we've experienced in the past, like floods from 1982 or the earthquake of 1989. This is multiple issues happening. And I just have already been hearing for the last number of months that there's a limit to what the staff can do. And there's no doubt that this would add to that right now. So it seems to me that unless somebody can really give a compelling reason for doing it now, other than there's never a good time, I would say that this is couldn't be the worst time. Thank you.
Alana Lang?
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
Hi, Alina Lang, Boulder Creek. Ratepayer. So I just wanted to say that our watershed is a connected ecosystem and it doesn't understand our district boundaries. Well, there is a great benefit in managing a larger part of this watershed as a whole, and it would allow the two districts to pursue more ecological enhancements. The merger would also allow for more efficient use of the available budget, which in the end would benefit our water customers. So I just wanted to say that I support this exploration of the merger. Thank you.
Thank you, Alina. Beth Hollenbeck?
Hello, good evening. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Hi, yes, thank you. And thank you for your service, board. Appreciate it. Yeah, I just wanted to piggyback on Beth Thomas. I was born here in 1963 in Felton, and I can tell you that nothing has affected this area as much as the CZU fire on top of the pandemic. Not even, I mean, 1982 was horrible, 1989. This is extreme situation in the San Lorenzo Valley. Those of us who have lived here our whole life know that. And I wish everybody on the board would really just take sensitivity to what so many people are speaking to that have been born and raised in this area. There's also, you know, droughts that we've all lived through for years. I know there was a bad one in the 70s and when about 20 years ago, how many years where we had signs out in front of our house? So this is always this looming drought that we have in our area. And then as I always say, I have to say that Felton owned water that we pay $600 a year in property taxes with liens against our home on top of the 120 rate increase that we've gotten in the last, you know, 10 years has been, it's very much something that I think Felton has a huge right to be involved in this and to have a say in this with our water. And lastly, does LAFCO really have to be involved in the exploration? And is Fish and Game going to be involved in this exploration? So those are my main concerns and things that I hope you will consider, and that Felton would be definitely something either paid back if this happened or something, since we're spending a lot of money to not have our water shipped out as it was proposed to us in the bond. Thank you.
Do you want to respond to her, Rick?
You know, not really. I think the feasibility study would be able to respond better. You know, I'm not convinced that, you know, most likely we have looked at back of the envelope. There could be considerable savings, and that will be passed on to our customers. Hopefully less rate increases, less percentage of rate increases. So all the things that, you know, Director Foltz just rightly pointed out about our operating costs. Until I see the feasibility study that says, you know, what the consolidation would do, you know, I'm on the fence too. I'm not 100% supportive of the consolidation until we get a detailed engineering report and a feasibility report and hear from, you know, and let our customers review that information and then have this discussion moving forward.
I was just going to say that she asked a specific question about the involvement of LAFCO at this stage.
LAFCO has to be, that's the law. LAFCO will have to be involved in this discussion. Fish and Wildlife, most likely there'll be an environmental comment that Fish and Wildlife will comment as well.
Well, but as I understood this, so does that mean that the feasibility study that we're doing right now would actually involve LAFCO or not?
I apologize, I misunderstood the question. Yeah. LAFCO, I don't believe, has to be involved.
I think that's important.
I apologize, I didn't understand. But, and Council Nichols, am I correct on that? On a feasibility study, LAFCO needs no involvement?
I don't think there's any reason why they would have to be involved. It'll, at a later stage, you know, the reports that the district does may need to meet their requirements, but I don't see any reason why that would need to be the case now. They would need to be involved now.
I think as I understood your introduction, Rick, it was that this feasibility study is kind of the pre-first step. In other words, it would bring back a report that we would then decide whether we want to begin the process. And at that point, LAFCO would be involved. So as I understand it, we're sort of voting on, you know, we're not voting to go ahead, we're voting on getting some information kind of along the lines of what Lois.
Asking the board to a feasibility study to get additional information to help make decisions down the road. This is not a decision to approve consolidation. It's the feasibility study would gather more information.
Thank you. Jim Mosher.
Can you hear me? Can you hear me
yes.
now? Great.
Yes.
I'm Jim Mosher from Felton. I would urge the board to table this proposal. I've lived here since 1976. This is such an extraordinary time that we're going through. I don't see this as something, as other people said. I won't repeat what other people said about this, but this is an absolutely extraordinary time. And this proposal is going to take an enormous amount of time, not only for the board and the staff, but for the community. I just think about my own time. This would become the number one issue for ratepayers. I know this from all the people I've talked to. People are very, very concerned about this. Instead of focusing on things like fire, getting ready for the next fires, rebuilding, dealing with being prepared for debris flow, working on infrastructure, this is going to take over the discussion in the valley. It's going to be distracting. It's going to be conflictual. There's a lot of misinformation, and I agree that it'd be great to get some more information, but I do not think it is a good idea for us to move forward this in any formal way. On the other hand, I think it would be great to continue to work with Scotts Valley, get to know them better. There are ways in which we can collaborate, explore conjunctive use, start introducing this idea to the community in a more informal way. I'm also very concerned about how you would be communicating this to ratepayers. The district doesn't have a very good track record of communication. This consultant is somebody who won't know the valley. Many, many of the concerns that people have nothing to do with the finances of this. It has to do with this is our board in the valley. We have only two elected boards. Scotts Valley has a city council. We don't. We're very concerned that this board has as part of its mission protecting the watershed. As far as I know, Scotts Valley does not have any environmental protection mission themselves. These are the kinds of concerns that people are going to raise. How are those going to be addressed and how will they be communicated, especially when we have to do it all by Zoom and we can't get together. So I urge you to table this. Thank you.
Tony Norton.
Hi, this is Pete Norton, actually. I had a few comments here. The first one was the managers have evidently been discussing this for some time. And you said, Rick said there was some low hanging fruit like cutting staff and consolidating offices. But there's got to be more than that. I think it would be very important for the managers to come up with a list of possible benefits and possible detriments and present that to the board and the public, not to have to go and get a consultant to do that. It wouldn't have to be detailed cost-wise or anything like that, but just a general couple of pages on what the benefits might be, so that the board could make a more informed decision about whether to move forward with hiring a consultant. My other point was that you had said with the ad hoc committee, it sounds like the only real purpose that they would have would be to design an RFP for the consultant. Is that correct? Anyway, that's what I'm hearing here, that the ad hoc committee themselves wouldn't be able to really investigate anything without hiring the consultant. So that seems a little premature, maybe, to have that committee where they can't really do anything. What can they do if the managers can't even come up with a list of what the benefits are? I think it would be advantageous to at least wait until there was a comprehensive list of what the benefits might be, and I think that's I had something else, but I can't think of it, so that's it for now.
Okay, thank you. Joe Kenny? Joe Kenny, are you there?
I'm trying. Did that work?
Yes.
Okay, so I live in Ben Lomond, and there's a couple things I wanted to address. And I work for a nonprofit. I understand how stretched staff in all of our government and nonprofit areas are right now. So in terms of savings, it would be bringing on more than the number of ratepayers are currently in the system, if I'm understanding, because there's more people in Scotts Valley than there are in the Valley.
No, Scotts Valley is about half the size in terms of connections.
In terms of connections. Okay, so you're bringing on half the size. You might save money with one district manager, but you're gonna need way more people because you're serving another 50%. So the people who process all of the fees every month, all those different kinds of things, the people who read the meters, all that has to be expanded. We have no control over what happens with Scotts Valley and the number of new units they put in. And you know it's a growth territory right now. It's the only part of the county that's really growing. There's going to be a detailed engineering report and the feasibility study. I only saw $40,000+ talked about the feasibility study, but no price attached to the detailed engineering report. I, for one, would really like to see that. And then the other is, you just approved a $15 million loan to pay for all these new projects. Who's going to coordinate those projects? Who's going to make sure they're really happening? The staff. So on one hand, you're opening up for all these new things to be able to fix problems in this district and adding half the number of new connections with no anticipation of expanding staff, if that's what I'm hearing. And the other thing that was concerning for me in particular was that Scotts Valley is operating at a deficit. I mean, let's just find out why they're operating at a deficit and why we wouldn't be picking that up from them. I don't see any advantage. I'm sorry. It sounds like a pretty expensive endeavor for not even having an idea of whether this is worth it or not. I also want to mention something that somebody else brought up, is we are all in a heightened state of stress. If COVID weren't enough, we've got, you know, a bad water situation coming down the pike. We have people who've lost their homes. We have a lot of people who've lost their jobs. I'd like to take that money, if it's extra money, that would go into this study and give people rate hikes. I mean, rate, what's the word? Breaks. So I'm sorry I'm not making much sense here, but you can hear the stress in my voice. Multiply that by the number of people in the district, and that's what you're facing with. So put it off. Thank you.
Shar?
Hi, I'm Charlene Cece. I live in Ben Lomond. And I don't like to repeat what everybody said, but in this case, I think it, first of all, I'm not a fan of this at this point for a lot of the reasons. One, last time you said they came to you with the idea, and you weren't even thinking about a merger, and now you've got this idea of a merger and you're sort of running with it. And that's not always a good idea. You know, it really could be some short-term gains, like the last speaker said, of maybe getting rid of a one administrative position. And then there's all the long-term consequences that many of us have mentioned. Once consultants get their feet in the door, they keep on getting funded. I've seen it at the county, I've seen it at the city, I've seen it other places where I've lived and paid attention. I'd also like to know about Scotts Valley's deficit. You know, they have their staff is larger than ours, and they have half the hookup, so I'm not understanding that. And when you all spoke, you really didn't address us, we the ratepayers, and I was kind of put off by that. I just want to again echo, it's a horrible time. I know people in the Valley, as you do, who have, they're not even back in their homes yet, and there's so much to be done. So I just want to see this. I don't even know if I want it to go forward, but I really think it is, you know, you talk about not a good time, but there can be the worst time, and this, I think, is one of them. So thank you.
Larry Ford?
Thank you. This is Larry Ford, resident of Felton. I really appreciate all the comments that people have made so far. And I'm clearly in the camp that says now is not the time to do this, but that the idea is interesting. Certainly, Rick and Lois, I trust your wise judgment and long experience, but I don't agree. I don't follow how it is that you got to those decisions. In fact, I wonder if, as others have said in a different way, are we trying to put the cart before the horse here? Why do we need to consolidate to get the benefits that are, you know, that we're talking about? Most of the benefits that I've heard about are very speculative. And so I just don't follow it. And I would like to hear more about why this is even the best option. What other options besides consolidation or merger would work? Could we work together somehow? Are there certain things that SLV Water District would like to be able to get from Scotts Valley? That kind of thing. And so I too am really concerned about all the other issues that we have to face right now. The one that really worries me is that the next fire season is about to come, in probably in May. And it could be just as bad as the last one. And if that were to happen, it would be setting us back just as much, if not more, than the previous fire. We learned from the fire management consultants that the CZU fire on the SOV side was low to moderate severity. That really freaks me out, because that suggests that we could have a fire just as bad as that, or even worse. And I could go on about how that might happen, but I'm really concerned that we need to be mobilizing all the resources in the district to make sure that we're protecting infrastructure before some kind of another big fire comes in. Anyway, that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Larry. Lorraine Palmer.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
Great, thank you so much for taking my call. First thing I wanted to say is Rick has mentioned a back of the envelope calculation, and he also mentioned certain retirement opportunities for savings. If you've had those conversations or done those calculations, can you please publish them to the community, organizational charts and anticipated retirements, and how those, how our staffs of the two water districts might be merged? You already must know this. So can you please publish it to people instead of just saying, wait, paying a consultant $40,000 to tell us? And you know, your back of the envelope calculations, they must include more than just staffing. So can you please publish to us all the things that you've already had in your mind and you've thought and discussed and you've calculated? But can you please publish that and not wait for consultants to tell us? And then the second point I want to make is, as many people have mentioned, Scotts Valley is a pro-development environment. And, you know, water is a resource that is necessary for development. And the Valley has a very different development profile. How would you possibly tell Scotts Valley, no, you can't develop more? We're not going to give our water to you to build more McMansions, more houses, you know, to overdevelop. You know, if you don't have the resources to build the houses now, you shouldn't come to San Lorenzo Valley and ask us for our water so you can build more houses. Because somebody's going to make a whole lot of money, some developer's going to make a whole lot of money on that, and then walk away and leave the problem with our communities to, you know, have worse droughts because we run out of water. And, you know, we have to keep rationing, and somebody's making a lot of money and walking away. So I don't really want to support giving our water to Scotts Valley so they can keep developing. And it's no personal offense to anybody in Scotts Valley. And the third point I want to continue to make, which I made on the first meeting we had, is that it's not, you know, as many people have said, it is not just a bad time. It is a very, very bad time. It's probably the worst time that any of us will experience in our entire lives to be adding something to people's plates. People are overwhelmed, and this is the very most wrong time to do this. And I just want to say that, like, the outreach, how are you going to outreach to 1,000 families who are gone? Are you going to track all those people down and talk to them and explain all this to them and say, I know that you're living in another state right now and you haven't finished, you know, you're not finished rebuilding and you haven't moved back, but we want you to understand this and you have a stake in this, you know? How is that outreach going to happen? I mean, you guys don't do very good with outreach on normal issues that we've had for, you know, decades here. So I don't see you rising above and beyond to this extraordinary level of outreach. I just don't see it happening. And that's putting the Valley at a huge disadvantage because, you know, people aren't here to vote. So there you go.
Thank you, Lorraine.
Thank you.
Joe Serrano.
Good evening, board members. Joe Serrano, executive officer for LAFCO. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Thank you for this opportunity to address the board. I just wanted to provide some additional information. There was a question about, does LAFCO have to be involved with exploration or the feasibility study process? And the answer is no. This is the opportunity for the residents and the board to gather information, and LAFCO doesn't need to be a part of it. That said, LAFCO can be used as a resource if you want us to help. So I'll leave that door open, but we do not have to be part of this process. The second thing is about timing. There's always a question about timing. And actually, historically, when disasters or challenging times occur, that's when neighboring agencies band together to help one another. Typically, when things are going well, partnerships are not really needed or considered. But especially nowadays, because of the pandemic, the fires, all these type of disasters and fiscal distress happening, the idea of consolidation is being considered throughout the state. So it's not just these two water districts that are considering it. It's being thought of in the state of California. So I just wanted to bring that up, that that's when challenging times occur, that's when neighboring agencies really look together and see, is consolidation going to help the residents, yes or no? And one more question that I wanted to address is, are there any other options besides consolidation? And the answer is yes. And the feasibility study can be an opportunity to identify other opportunities. Maybe consolidation doesn't work for your residents, but perhaps some other type of partnership will benefit. That's something that can be explored in the feasibility study. And as your board members mentioned, it's facts. They'll make it clear for your residents to determine what makes sense and what will benefit them. With that, thank you for the opportunity, and I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Libby and Tom?
Okay, so I think I unmuted. Can you hear me now?
Oh. Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Yes, Tom, we can hear you.
Delay. So this is Tom Purdy. My wife's in the other room. We're in Ben Lomond, and couple of quick comments. One is, my initial reaction is I'm a little skeptical of the benefit to Santa Luisa Valley of merging with Scotts Valley. Hopefully the feasibility study will give us some ideas of what the benefits are. I guess my skepticism is a fear that they're basically, since they're growing, be a drain on our water resources, whereas our use of the water resources are maybe more stable. I'm okay with the feasibility study, but I think it's really important that it be designed to be impartial and bring out all the relevant facts. And probably even more important, as you've already heard from a lot of the skepticism tonight, it's going to be really important to get the community involved, not only in the inputs to the feasibility study, but in terms of keeping people abreast of what comes up. Because if that doesn't happen, you're going to get a lot of people who just won't buy into the idea. And also not quite sure why it's necessary to do this now, but maybe that would be something else that comes out of the feasibility study. So that's really all I have to say.
Thank you, Tom. Rick Moran?
Yes, Rick Moran from Ben Lomond. I've spent about a year and a half going to Santa Margarita Groundwater Agency meetings on the fourth Thursday of every month. And the city, the Scotts Valley Water District, Scotts Valley Water District and San Lorenzo Valley were working together. We're trying to come up with a mutually agreed upon way to resolve some of these same issues that are discussed in this merger. All right, but so far in these meetings, we've really just agreed on definitions and goals. And what is coming up is the funding for the various projects that are gonna have to be done. And some of the projects are done in Scotts Valley, some of the projects may be done in San Lorenzo Valley. And it hasn't been really worked on how that money is gonna be fairly distributed. And, you know, so I like working with Scotts Valley. I think there's plenty of fine people over there. But until we can work, demonstrate that we can work together and come up with mutually agreed upon decisions here that are fair to all of us, I think we should wait. You know, we have the Santa Margarita to can demonstrate, be an example of how we can work together. And if we can, then we can come back to this and talk about a possible merger. But I think the first step is we should make sure that we can do our finances with the Scotts Valley Water District before we jump into a full set on merger. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Rick. Catherine? Catherine, are you there? Did we already hear from Lorraine?
Chair Mayhood, I believe we did. So yeah, this would be okay. A second round of comments.
All right. Well, I think we should go back to the board and Beth Dyer, we haven't heard from you.
Good evening, board. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay. I have a couple of comments. I think you're wise to consider a feasibility study in this matter. However, I think the reality of a feasibility study may be somewhat different than what happened with the fire districts in terms of cost, and scoping may also be an issue, because a pricey issue, because water is far more complicated than many other things, as all of us living in California know. So I think that $40,000, you should easily double that and probably much more to get the type of comprehensive answers that would be really beneficial for decision making. And also, other callers have alluded to the fact that consultants like to add on the scoping in terms of what you get out at the end of the process. It's really important that the scoping is done very well. Otherwise, the board would be looking at a document that may or may not serve your needs and may require more time. And I could not agree more with other callers, of which there have been several. This is a rather poor time to be adding on work. I've been a consultant. I've been in the position of managing a consultant as a staff person for a public agency, and it can be very time intensive. And if you just let the consultant run off and do things without engaging at the appropriate level, you may regret that decision. So I just wanted to put those considerations out there, and good luck.
Okay. Cynthia Denzel.
I don't know that was very well stated, but I think I hit the points I wanted to hit. They need to.
I appreciate what the last caller said. I believe the consultant is only going to come up with information that staff gives them, either from Scotts Valley or from SLV Water District. From my conversations with Scotts Valley residents, they think that we are anxious to join with them because we are in financial difficulty. They are against development just as much as we are, but it's the county that decides who gets to have new buildings or not, rather than the water district. And so I think all of us ratepayers in both areas are looking for a way to stop development, but it's not through the water district that we're going to be able to do that. I don't know if there's any advantage to us joining with them in trying to limit development, whether that would give us any clout or not. But I think that what I hear is from both sides, there's a lot of skepticism about what the advantages are to joining. And I think it's up to our directors to provide more information. I think the ad hoc committee is a good idea. If all they do is do their own research, and that means they have to have access to information from both water districts. Thank you.
Thank you, Cynthia. I think the two remaining names, we've heard from both of them, haven't we, Gina?
Well, Chair Mahuta, I believe you tried to call on Catherine.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Del Masso, and she wasn't able to comment.
Okay. Then, Catherine, you want to try again?
Excuse me, Chair.
I just got a call from the CTV, and there's something about Catherine's process that she's contacting us that he cannot unmute her.
Okay. So
she will not be, she'll have to send in her comment or question to the district.
Kristen?
Hello?
Yes, we can hear you, Kristen.
Oh, great. Yeah, I know this is very preliminary and just really at the start of the process, but one of my major concerns right now is that any proposal for consolidation has to be done as transparently as possible and with as much public information given out as possible. And because all of these meetings are still happening on Zoom, it's quite difficult to ensure that, especially, you know, with people being scattered from the fires. People may not even be aware that this is happening. It was quite difficult for me to find and access this meeting. And I know that this is not, you know, I'm not alone in that. So, you know, beyond all of the issues with the consolidation itself, there needs to be a lot more outreach to people who have a stake in this. So, yeah, and then I do have concerns about just the severity of the displacement from the CZU fire, the number of people who either lost their houses or are not able to be in their houses right now, who, you know, are just not paying attention to this process at all. And you need to make sure that they understand what's happening and what the stake is and, you know, what their role in it is. So thank you for your time.
Rick, would you like to just say how many of our ratepayers' homes were destroyed by, or they had to have their shut off? So we have an idea. Somebody mentioned 1,000, but that's the total number of houses, not the ones that are in San Lorenzo Valley.
Right. I believe our connections are approximately 120 folks in our receiving service. But obviously, this would impact our entire district. So the number is, you know, much greater. Even so, they're not being supplied water. It would still have an impact on all of our people in our district. We would want to be sure that we got the word out to everybody in our district.
Right. Can we unmute the people that are on telephone lines so that we can see? I think I see only the one, but can we just unmute that one briefly so that in case they have a question? So the person on the telephone line, did you have a comment? Okay, hearing none. Are there any more questions, people who haven't spoken already? Okay, then I would like to go back to the board. And can I start with Director Smalley?
Yes. We heard several questions from the public that I'd like to put to you, Rick. One was, why do this now? And that's following along what I was saying also. Why now versus when we are out of this pandemic restrictions?
I totally understand that question. I just don't think, you know, Scotts Valley knocked at our door just before mm-hmm. the fire and re-brought up the situation just recently, right before we brought it to the board. I felt it wasn't my decision to put it off alone. I thought it was a board decision to address. And again, I will say that, you know, as you heard, people are already concerned about the next fire, the next earthquake. I've been here almost all my life. I've worked for the Water District for going almost 44, 45 years. I don't ever believe there's anything, any time will be a good time.
Grants you sometimes are better than others, and this is an unprecedented time that with the fire and the pandemic, I think Zoom is a great way to get information out. People are distracted. Most of these people have been on the call tonight, and we have heard from our paths. My path has crossed with them at one time or another. I know most of these people, and I understand their concerns. And it is a difficult decision to somewhat move forward. But I think from all the questions I heard, the feasibility study, including what Joe Serrano said, the feasibility study will tell us which way would be the best way for us to go. And I understand concerns about consultants. Most of what people said are true about, once you get in the consultant, you've got to be careful and monitor. But I think we owe it to our ratepayers and our customers to at least get some questions answered, a piece of the puzzle, and then maybe put the puzzle back on the shelf. But let's keep looking, moving this ahead. My mind's not made up one way or another. It's just I feel that we owe it to our customers to take it and then do a feasibility study to see what the benefits are. And it may stop them for a while. It's not a big lift, I don't believe, staff-wise and board-wise, to do the feasibility study. And the caller who said that this study may be a lot more, it could be, because a lot of this is complicated, but we would not be committed until the board and public and Scotts Valley saw what that price was and what that a feasibility study consisted of.
Okay. Another question that I wanted to ask based on what I heard from a couple members of the public as to what are the benefits, and is that something that between you and the district manager from Scotts Valley Water District could jointly come up with to provide us that two pages max of here are the potential benefits, here are potential downsides, to come back to us a month from now with that.
Yes, I mean,
what about that as a possibility?
Definitely, Mark. We could do that. I also think though that the community wants to hear that from a neutral party, mm-hmm. To review what staff would say, and a neutral party to review that and give comment. And there may be, what I'm thinking are, yes, the district manager from Scotts Valley and I took the low-hanging fruit, one district manager, one admin building. SLV Water has been moving to reconstruct a new admin operations facility. We bought property, we own several buildings. We're looking at anywhere maybe from about a $2.5 to $3 million project. One admin building would be a considerable savings. Staffing, there would be other areas of staffing. But there's also areas that possibly the district manager of Scotts Valley and I did not. We're not consolidators, so to speak. We run water districts. And would have other thoughts. And then the question about why don't we just sell them our surplus water, maybe our Loch Lomond allotment. We haven't used our Loch Lomond allotment. It doesn't do us any good sitting in Loch Lomond. We could sell that, get it back in the aquifer. That has a lot of benefit. Why not, we need to look at that. And we would, that's what would come out of a feasibility study. Our best ways forward.
Okay.
It would be good to keep the process moving, even so we don't really move into a formal move for consolidation. It's good to keep working with Scotts Valley. It's good getting these questions answered and keep moving in that direction.
Okay. Thank you. That's all of my questions.
Director Tu?
I didn't have any more questions at this time. Thank you.
Director Fultz?
Yes. Well, I really appreciate everybody taking the time out tonight to attend this very critical meeting. And again, everything that you've said, in my opinion, cuts right to the heart of the matter. And that's, this is not purely a financial decision, even though that certainly is part of it. I have not heard anything tonight to change my mind from the last meeting. However, in the interest of transparency, I think that we and myself, or speaking for myself, owe the community our thoughts about this in a comprehensive fashion. So I have a statement that I prepared earlier that I want to read and have it included in the minutes later on. I remain deeply skeptical about the cost reduction proposals I've heard so far as one reason to consolidate. We have been unable to do cost reductions in a relatively small district where operating costs have increased by multiples of inflation over the last 10 years. If anything, it's going to be harder to control costs at a larger agency. Further, I am puzzled by this push for consolidation given what I've heard about forecasted water usage. As articulated by the Scotts Valley Water District Manager at their meeting discussing this, they are forecasting only 0.26% growth in water usage per year, or slightly over 2.6% over the next 10 years compounded. I remain skeptical of that number in light of the city of Scotts Valley's drive to grow their way out of their fiscal situation, but let's take that number at face value. Based on their current usage, that represents a ramp up to 10.5 million gallons more than they're producing now, between now and 2031. That's less than 2% of our current production. If Scotts Valley is looking to level off their usage of the ancient aquifers they're currently tapping into, I would be happy as part of the Santa Margarita Groundwater Agency activity to find a way to sell our surplus water to help them out. Or Scotts Valley could purchase surplus water from Santa Cruz, assuming they have a surplus in light of their growth efforts as well. And then I think we need to look at the political economy issues. The San Lorenzo Valley is a no-growth area, as many of you have noted. That was voted into decades ago and reinforced by county actions since. Scotts Valley is a fast-growth area, becoming more urban with each passing year. A consolidation will result in our district focus rapidly shifting to serve those development efforts in Scotts Valley. That's just the nature of the beast. And remember, Scotts Valley receives $22,000, the water district receives $22,000 for each single family dwelling connection, at least, $13,000 for more of their pack and stack denser development, and they get another $6,000 for each recycled water connection. So imagine 100 unit mixed development, they get a minimum of $1.3 million, and maybe up to as much as $2 million in capital. That's a lot of money. So I've heard from a lot of people that there's a concern that Scotts Valley just wants our water. That may be true, but would Scotts Valley worry that we just want their development money? Is that the bargain here? And is the development money available to a consolidated district to improve infrastructure worth that bargain? At this point, I agree that more analysis and answers are needed. However, I don't agree with this recommendation. As a district, we're busy. We have at least a year of intensive work on fire recovery, not to mention the fire hardening activities we should be starting this year. We're about 6 months from wrapping up the Santa Margarita Groundwater Agency draft. We have a large number of capital infrastructure projects underway. We need to finish our multi-year budgeting and provide our true financial picture of our capital obligations. We need to finish our inventory project. We are working through a series of CEQA and water rights processes so we can start managing our district resources as a whole. All of these items have enormous strategic implications, and they're all input into a possible review of a potential consolidation. So we might as well finish those and not invest a lot of time in consulting dollars and feasibility studies. Folks, I already know that the consolidation is feasible. We already know that the consolidation is feasible. Our community knows that. We don't need to use our money to pay someone to figure that out. What I need to see, and what I think our community needs to see, is a compelling story as to why. And the consultant isn't going to tell us that. Only our staff can tell us that. Like Mark, I recommend that we ask the two district managers to collaborate on a term sheet. This term sheet should provide the strategic reasons for doing this in a very concrete and transparent fashion. It should address the concerns that have been raised by the community, and we've heard, I think, an enormous number of those already. And I recommend that they include a section on governance, including board composition and suggested policies. In addition, this term sheet should provide sufficient financial information on operating cost savings through headcount identification and other efficiencies that we as a community will be able to get a good picture of what they have in mind. Are we talking about a savings of 300,000 or 3 million? I don't think we have to do a consolidated budget. I think we can just mash up the two budgets together and subtract out the items that have been identified. And they should also include alternatives to consolidation, such as long-term water sharing and other items that might come out of the Santa Margarita Groundwater Agency process. Because as a number of you have said, all an outside consultant is going to do is interview the two district managers and senior staff and produce a report based on that information. But let's just cut out the middleman. I believe that our district managers, with support from senior staff and from board members, are more than capable of collaborating on this term sheet. They can provide updates to the board over the next few months as they go along. I anticipate this process taking about 6 months. And then in the fall, once we're putting more of these really pressing items behind us, and with that term sheet in hand, we can come back and re-examine the topic and re-engage in a debate with real information. If the document produced is compelling enough, then we could even take action to create an ad hoc committee or hire a consultant at that time, or perhaps better yet, put the question up for a vote of our community at the next election. While I understand there is a vote during the LAFCO process, if we get that far, it's a negative vote and at the tail end of the process when everything's mostly a done deal and all the money's been spent. And in general, I'm not a big fan of late in the day negative votes that aren't associated with an election process. I think a positive voting process will give a much clearer picture of the will of the people. I also heard our district manager express concerns that failing to consolidate with Scotts Valley will open the door to Scotts Valley consolidating with others, Santa Cruz. Well, let's address that in the term sheet as part of the strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats section. On the face of it, Scotts Valley and Santa Cruz may be more compatible since both are cities, both want to grow rapidly, both are facing fiscal challenges that they hope are going to be remediated by growth. And they have complementary water systems, Santa Cruz surface, Scotts Valley wells. But I'd also say that given the 8-to-1 difference in customer count, the citizens of Scotts Valley may not be well served by being swallowed by a behemoth whose main priorities lie firmly elsewhere and who are already focused on assisting Soquel Creek. And above all, let's look for that term sheet to be open and transparent. Lots of sunshine so that we can put to rest all of the speculation that we've seen in social media these past few weeks. Thank you for your attention. I'm looking forward to continuing the conversation.
Director Henry?
Okay. Well, to just address something Director Fultz just said about Scotts Valley merging with Santa Cruz. I see a big problem with that because the basin, the Santa Margarita Basin, is Scotts Valley and SLV and part of the county that oversees well owners. And if let's just say for kicks that Santa Cruz and Scotts Valley merged and Scotts Valley became part of Santa Cruz, they would have part of our aquifer. We would lose control as far as I'm concerned. And that is a concern. All I want here is facts. And I don't want to hear facts from Director Rogers. Not Director Rogers, pardon me. District Manager Rogers and District Manager Perret Harmon. I want neutral information from somebody who doesn't have an oar in the water. I want facts. I said this before. That's all I ask for is facts and something to make a good decision on. Because my first reaction was, uh-uh. But when I have time to think about it, I'm feeling a whole lot more open-minded about it. Not so open-minded, my brains have fallen out. I just want information. I just want facts. That's all.
Thank you, Director Henry. I guess I'll weigh in here. I have very ambivalent ideas, and I've gone back and forth on this, and it's largely because we know that the San Lorenzo Valley Water District is a product of many annexations over time and consolidations with smaller districts. And the reasons that drove those processes are still in play today. The difficulty of small districts responding to natural disasters, raising capital for infrastructure, paying for adequate staff. And of course, those are just going to get worse in the future as rainfall patterns become more erratic and fires increase in a warming world. So I think that I see regionalization of management of water resources and consolidations and efforts to gain economies of scale through them is an inevitable part of our future. We don't know the pluses and minuses of a potential consolidation with Scotts Valley Water District and how those would stack up, because we out, and that's kind of what we're trying to vote on today is whether to find out. But my feeling on this is that I don't support doing that. And this is because I feel that this is not the time for us to undertake this project. We have a lot of work to do on the infrastructure, repairing fire damage, and we've also got five pipeline projects that we're undertaking as part of this $15 million that we just got a loan for. Our staff is dealing with COVID, and they've had to deal with debris flow threats, so that causes them extra work. And I guess I've been very struck when at the previous meeting and this one is I've been impressed by it, how our ratepayers are really suffering under the losses that have been imposed by the fire, the two evacuations, one for fire, one for debris flows, continuing concerns about debris flows, and the COVID pandemic and all the stresses that come with isolation, homeschooling kids, and losses of people that have been ill or died. So I feel like this is not the time to take on a project that will lead to upsets and division in the community. And so the question is, that's fair enough. We could always slow walk the process. There's nothing that says if you start to undertake consolidation that you have to zip through as fast as you can. But you could argue that way that, well, we might as well go ahead with this feasibility study now. But the problem I have with that is that hopefully 3 years from now, when we might be in a better position to take on this kind of workload, when presumably a lot of these pipeline projects are done or underway, or the fire repair infrastructure repairs are underway, that things will change. In other words, our financial situation will have changed over those 3 years, and certainly that of Scotts Valley. The other thing is that Santa Margarita is going to come out with a study that, as was mentioned by Mark and by Rick Moran, and I would like to know what that is going to state in terms of what's going to be imposed on us by that whole process, and we won't know that till next February or so. So my feeling is that I think we're likely to end up regionalizing water management, but I think we should wait, and we should put it off for at least 3 years, and we might as well put off any sort of feasibility study we do until that time as well. Okay. Any other board members like to have additional comments at this time? Okay. Oh, sorry. Rick, did you want to respond?
I do. I just, and as I've said, early on that, I can easily go either way on this. The district has plenty to do, as stated. But if we don't move ahead on the feasibility study, Mark's questions, if we could get a page or two of the pros and cons, yes, we could do that. But Director Fultz's level of analysis, we do not have staff time for that. That is a huge undertaking for staff. A back of the envelope, quick and dirty, if the board so desires. But what I don't want the board to do is say that we're not interested in moving ahead on a feasibility study, but we want staff to turn around this report. We don't have the bandwidth for that. But we could get the back of the napkin some information.
I guess I am totally in agreement on that. And that was actually, I wanted to add that to my comments, that I thought that what Director Fultz was suggesting just went entirely against the idea that this isn't the right time and is that we have so many other things to do, because that would be very time consuming. So I think.
Actually, if I may say, it absolutely isn't. And let me explain what I mean, because I think you're reading into it a lot more than I suggested. Basically, what I'm talking about putting together is exactly the couple pages on a strategic view of this that Mark was talking about. I was agreeing with him, as well as a little summary budget that basically says, here's the operating costs for both districts, and here's what we're going to subtract out due to the cost savings that we think we can achieve based on headcount, operating efficiencies, whatever else is there. At most, this might be a couple of days' work. But, Rick, you seem to always jump to something way beyond what I'm suggesting and intending. So I don't get that. But that is absolutely all that we need at this point. And that's why I said I think it can be done in 6 months. And at that point in time, we'll have the first draft of Santa Margarita out. And at that point in time, we can then be better positioned to regroup and say affirmatively yes or no.
Anybody else like to make a comment? Director Tu.
Hi, thank you. I'm actually with Rick and with Director Henry on this. I think that having at least an ad hoc committee to go forward with the feasibility to develop an RFP, it won't cost us anything. It's a 6 month process to do that alone. And then when the 6 months is over, we have an RFP ready. And then we can decide at that time whether or not that's something that we want to do. I think that, going forward with an ad hoc committee costs us nothing. And it's worthwhile doing right now, so that in the future, if we do decide to go forward to think about getting a feasibility study, then it's already on hand and we don't have to spend another 6 months doing that. So that's my take on the current matter. Thank you.
I think if I can just correct that, I think the idea is that the 6 months would include a feasibility study So in other words,
So I misunderstood that part.
Yeah. So I think the timeline on this is, correct me if I'm wrong, Rick, but is that we would appoint a committee, and that committee would craft an RFP, and that would go out, and then the committee would what the bids were, And then the board would decide whether they wanted to proceed with those, but hopefully that would be fairly quick. And so that we could be in a position at the end of 6 months to look at the finalized report by not only the consultant, but any work that the committee wanted to do by talking to staff or talking to people at Scotts Valley. Is that fair enough, Rick?
That's fair enough.
Yeah.
Correct.
Okay. But I still think that it still doesn't cost us anything to get the committee going, if nothing else. And I think that's something worth considering.
Okay. Anybody else have a comment? Director Smalley, did you have anything else you wanted to add or?
I'm still of the opinion between the two district managers, and I would hope that it's not a months long process, but within a month to come up with the two pages that I'm asking about with, here's a sort of a high level pros and cons as to what do you see as the benefits of this? And I don't think that it needs to involve a lot of staff. I think you know a lot of these answers, or between you and Director Harmon or District Manager Harmon know that. But if you can get your collective thoughts down, written, so that we could look at it as a board.
Strongly agree with you, Mark. That I have no, okay. No issue with that.
Okay.
Would anybody like to make a motion?
I'll make a motion then.
Okay.
I'd like to request our district manager to contact the district manager at Scotts Valley Water District and prepare a brief summary of benefits, pros and cons, and include some type of a budget analysis along the lines of what Director Foltz is suggesting, to come back to the board with that.
I would second that, Mark.
Okay. Any further discussion? Did you want to put a time limit on that?
As I said, my thoughts would be within a month, but certainly no more than two.
All right.
For that, to then let us discuss further. Do we go ahead with the ad hoc committee? Do we go ahead with ad hoc committee attempting to prepare a feasibility study?
Okay.
Can I add maybe the April 15th meeting would be appropriate?
Okay.
No, Bob, you're shaking your head.
I think maybe the first meeting in May. I'd like to make sure we give Rick and Pred a good amount of time to do this. Personally, myself, I don't think there's really a big rush and we could take it all the way to 6 months, but you know, I think 2 months is sort of a minimum. You know.
Okay.
Okay, so we have a motion on the table that the board directs this district manager to work with the district manager, Brett Harmon at Scotts Valley, to create a document that lists pros and cons of a potential consolidation with a rudimentary budget that goes along with that to be produced by the first meeting in May.
That was a great summary, Dan. Fabulous.
I agree.
I do have a question.
Okay.
Can we make a decision for Perret Harmon, or if we can only ask Rick Rogers to do this?
Oh, we can only ask Rick.
We're just asking Rick to meet with her.
No.
If she chooses not to, well.
Consult with her.
I hear what Rick said.
I have all indications, Director Henry, that Perret will work with the district on I look at this as a very low level analysis for what we know. I may talk offline with Director Smalley on this with budget. I'm not quite sure what we're looking for on that, but I do not look at this as a big analysis moving forward.
I think that's what you intended, Director Smalley, right?
That's correct. Okay. Yes.
I think he's wanting to peel the onion.
Okay. Yes, let's take this a slice or a peel at a time. Thank you, Director Folstetz.
Okay. Are there any more questions or comments on the motion?
Can we go to the community?
I think we have to go to the public on this motion. So let me look at the list of attendees. And does anybody in the public want to comment on the motion on the table? Jim Mosher.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
I don't have a big objection to this, but it just strikes me that we're just kicking this down the road and that you're going to have another meeting with 60 to 100 people coming, probably telling you the same thing. It won't really matter what the back of the envelope says about the savings. I'd rather you just table this so that we can move on to the other issues that the district is facing. And I'm speaking as a member of a community group that's working on a variety of issues in the valley. I'd rather not have this one stay at the top of the list. I'd rather get to things like fire management, get ready for the next fire, deal with the pandemic, let's deal with infrastructure, let's deal with all the other issues we're dealing with. This is not something that needs to happen now. So I urge you to just table it. Thank you.
Bill Smallman.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can, Bill.
Okay. Oh, sorry, I'm new to all this. And anyway, I got a 4-minute thing, so I'd like to request an extra minute, after serving for 10 years as a water district director. I have a lot of important information here. It's really refreshing that I think that we should.
Mr. Smallman, everybody gets the same amount, which is 3 minutes.
Well, how about 4 minutes? I served 10 years for a water district director. So you're not going to give me
no,
an extra minute?
3 minutes, just like everybody else gets.
Well, thank you very much. So I'll cut to the chase.
Great.
I like to read a quote from Barack Obama. It reads, "All of us share the world for a brief moment of time. The question is whether we spend that time focused on what pushes us apart or whether we commit ourselves to an effort, a sustained effort to find a common ground to focus the future we seek for our children and respect for the dignity of all human beings." Look, I've served 10 years as a water district director, and all I suffered a lot of hate towards me. I had difficulty finding a job locally, and I wasn't around so I can take care of my teenage daughter. And I couldn't find a local job because of your hate. And I can feel it now. I can feel the hate coming from you right now. I can feel it. You're not going to give me an extra minute to talk about this when I have a lot of information, a lot of education about it. Yes, thank you, Bob, for your article on the op-ed. We are owners. And I'll cut to the chase because I know I'm going to run out of time. We're going to start protesting now. We're going to start protesting now. And I'm telling the public right now who's out there, we are against this merger and for a lot of reasons, which you're not going to give me time to describe about, but we're going to start sending you, send everybody in the public out there, send, start, don't stop, don't, we're going to start right now. and send a protest. It's a pledge that we're going to protest against this merger and send it to Gail G. Mahood and Rick Rogers at slv.com and send it to another third party. Send it to me, Bill at scwatersolutions.com. And we're going to start standing protests that we're going to pledge against this merger. Stop wasting your money on this nonsense. You know, Scotts Valley is overdeveloping and we're not going to put up with this stuff. So we want you to stop this right now. And we're going to pass out flyers. We're going to pass out everything out into the public. To send, all you got to send is an email with your water account number, your address to Gail, to Rick, and to me. Gail at scwaterscommunications.com. You know, it's not the right time. I agree with you, Gail, that it's not the right time for this to happen. And so we need to quit wasting our money on this nonsense.
Okay.
You know what?
Very much.
Well, you don't give me enough time. You know, I
CTV, thank you. Alina Liang.
Hi, I just wanted to say, like, I am kind of disappointed that the board isn't wanting to move forward on the ad hoc committee. I feel like these two districts have a lot to gain from this merger, and I am really worried about Santa Cruz and them coming in and trying to change our water rights and that fight that's going to happen there, and that we may end up on the losing end of this if we don't team up with Scotts Valley. So I think a lot what Lois Henry has to say has resonated with me, and I'm behind her. Thank you.
Thank you, Elena. Cynthia Denzel.
I want to thank you all for your time and the discussion, and I'm very happy with the final outcome because I think you've chosen a path that does not cost money and yet will bring us more information. So I thank you for your very well-reasoned decision tonight. And I agree with Jim Mosher in that we, and so many people, that we have other things that we have to worry about. But I'm glad that you are at least trying to find some facts, because I think that's what we're all looking for before we make final decisions. Thank you.
Thank you. Tom?
It takes it just a minute to remind me I have to unmute. So anyway, I just have one comment, and that is, I think in this two-pager that I believe you're asking to be put together, and it seems to me that's a great first start. You might put in there a little bit about any time issues. I mean, we've kind of talked around whether we can wait to do this for 1 year or 3 years, or whether it needs to happen now. So maybe Rick, you and the other director can put a couple bullets in there is about what is the time issue on this. That's my comment.
Okay, thank you, Tom. Rick Moran.
Hi, actually it's Chris Moran. I'm on Rick's computer. I would like to say, first of all, that I do think this is a bad time. I think that this is dragging it out. And the one thing I agree with is there is no good time for this. And I mean that, there's no good time for this idea. So this is a chess game. And so we consolidate with Scotts Valley, okay? And then we don't have any more control over it because we don't have a city council, we don't have a city manager. Then this gets taken over, and then they decide, when we're all consolidated, to go with Santa Cruz. And then they'll still have our Santa Margarita water. So Scotts Valley has more advantages than we do. So I just want to say that, one other thing I wanted to mention is that we went, where Santa's Village is, when you see all of those new houses from 17, when you look over there, you see all of these new townhouses. You go along the frontage road and you drive behind there, you are going to see a huge housing development. Rick and I drove back there about 2 weeks ago, and you can't see it, but it's back there. And this is why they want our water. And that's how I feel. And I think this is a really bad idea. I am very much against this. And all of our neighbors, everyone's concerned about this. So I hope you're listening. Thank you for all the work you guys do. I appreciate it. I'm done.
Yeah, thank you. Lee Sanders?
Thank you. I appreciate the opportunity. Your incredibly gentle approach to this topic has been much appreciated. My question is for our resident attorney representative, Gina Nichols. Is it allowable for the district to ask for all conversations between the two district managers to be recorded, transcribed, and made available to the public?
I don't typically respond, and I apologize, Mr. Sanders, directly to public comments. That'll have to be up to the board and the chair if they want to direct that to me following the public comment period.
Is there a quick answer to that? If not, we'll just let it ride.
Yeah, I don't think there's a quick answer to that.
Right. Lorraine Palmer?
Hello. Thank you for taking my comments earlier and considering answering, providing more information up front. I wanted to ask if your informational paper that you're going to produce would also include per capita usage for each of the two different districts and those numbers before the last drought and during the last drought, and how successful each district was in getting their customers to reduce their usage and conserve water. And can you get information and include in that report what the anticipated growth is, how many new connections each district is looking at over the next 30 years, and give us some projection of what that's gonna look like. Because once we give up our water rights, once we do once we consolidate, our rights as a San Lorenzo Valley community are forever changed. We can't undo that. So I'd like to know a much longer view, not just the immediate future. You know, what's it going to look like in 100 years? You know, so that's what I wanted to ask you to include in your report. Thank you.
Thank you, Lorraine. Kristen Sandel.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, I would just like to say that I agree with those who are in favor of tabling this motion for now, simply because it's such a large issue. And when you give up control of your water rights, you don't generally get them back. So I strongly feel that this should be dealt with at a later time. And so thank you to everyone who brought up that point, and thank you for your time.
Okay, thank you, Kristen. Beth Hollenbeck?
Hello, unmuted, thank you. Yes, Lorraine Palmer keeps hitting a lot of great points. Very, very intelligent speaker there. And I think that the one thing I have learned over the years and what many people have told me is that you want to look at the last 100 years and look at your worst case scenario and base any business decision on that. So the worst case scenario we would have in the San Lorenzo Valley, would we be able to provide for ourselves? You know, looking back and looking forward is very smart when it comes to propositions like this. These are huge decisions that will impact us, as so many people have said, for years to come. Having said that, I think that what Mark and Bob are proposing with you know, looking at operational costs of both districts is probably a good thing to do anyway, because you have said that there, that is one of the main reasons is because of deficits in operational costs, or that there were kind of not able to function fully. And so I would say, well, let's look at our own, you know, home and see what's going on and see if we can't resolve it. I'm, nobody's really talked about that. So I don't know if we've looked at that in the past or can see if that is something. It sounds like you were going to be consolidating jobs and stuff with Scotts Valley, but yeah, I think looking at operational costs and really taking that from both districts would be a smart thing to do anyway. It's just smart business. So that's what I have to say, and also to put this out. It's just too stressful for the community right now. Thank you.
Are there any more people that would like to be heard on this motion? Okay, and we'll come back to the board. I think we've already had a one round of comment, but if we have a motion on the table, and if anybody else wants to say something, we can, but I think I'd prefer to go to a vote if that's all right. I don't see any objection. Lois? Yes.
Well, I keep hearing that we're going to give up our water rights. That's not the deal. We would still exist. Scotts Valley would not. They're giving up theirs to us. I just want to make that in my mind. My understanding is Scotts Valley's smaller. They want to merge with us. Not that we want to merge with them. And we would not be giving up our water rights, period.
Okay. Holly, so I stated the motion. Man, I don't know if I can do it again.
Did such a great job the first time.
It was really great. I was reading, I was writing what Bob said, and you said it much better than I was writing. It's recorded, so if we could just go with that motion.
Yes.
Okay, President Mayhood.
Yes.
President Henry.
Yes.
Director Fulce.
Yes.
Director Smalley.
Yes.
And Director Tu.
Yes, with Vice President Henry.
Oh, I'm sorry. It was Vice President Henry. And so the motion passes. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. I just wanted to say that Tina was not feeling well tonight, and she was kind enough to come in so that we could vote on these two really important issues with the full board here and discuss them. So we're excusing her now to go back and put her jammies on and get into bed.
Thank you so much.
Feel better.
Thank you.
Next is the grand jury response.
Right, and Council Nichols will present this item to the board.
Okay, thank you, Chair Mayhood, District Manager Rogers. This is, of course, the second time this item is coming to the board. I'll provide the background fairly briefly, as I did last time. And that is, as certainly the board knows and many members of the public are aware, the Santa Cruz County Civil Grand Jury took a look at the district in 2017 and 2018 and issued a report in 2018 that's published on their website. The district provided a response to that report and then received a follow-up inquiry from the grand jury related to the implementation in 2019 and responded to that follow-up inquiry with a letter that's actually contained in the packet related to this item. Just recently, in February, the district received another follow-up inquiry from the grand jury, and that is what instigated this board item We prepared a draft, a very sort of simple draft response that we brought to the board at the prior regular meeting. And it received a lot of public comment and comments from the board. And we listened to those comments and incorporated a lot of that input into the revised draft response that you see in front of you here tonight. The district also wants to thank in particular Tony Norton, who's been the chair of the LADOC committee for some time, who took the time to provide written input, which is in the packet, and also comment on the draft response. Staff, we're hopeful that we have a final response here that the board could approve to send to the grand jury. It's got all of the backup materials that we plan to include with it. There was a slight change, by the way, to the proposed letter based on input we got from Ms. Norton. And that slight change was posted to the district's website on Monday. And it's just it's a change to the wording of the status update under item R3. That's all before the board. I'd really welcome any comments, in particular any specific edits or changes to be made to this letter. The grand jury was kind enough to grant an extension to us per our request discussed at the last board meeting, so we would have a little more time to get input and refine the response. But it is due next week, and all indications are that they're probably not going to entertain another extension. So it'd be appreciated if there are specific, if this letter could be approved, or if there are specific changes that we could work through them here this evening.
Okay. Director Faltz, would you like to start discussion?
I can. And I have a short statement on this. I appreciate the improvements that have gone into making the second draft of the letter better. But overall, I still think the letter falls short of where it needs to be in terms of transparency about the challenges the Long Peak community has faced during its integration into the larger SLVWD. And in that sense, I don't think the letter goes far enough in being specific about what has been done and what has not been done. So your invitation, Gina, I appreciate that. I don't know that we'll be able to go through that tonight, given the time pressures. If we had another meeting, maybe, but we don't. In particular, my concerns about this letter are heightened by statements that I've heard regarding the status of the Lompico Assessment District. It's out of money. Without that statement being immediately followed by, but we still have two major projects to do and we're committed to getting them done ASAP. I'm concerned that this statement is maybe subconsciously placing the Lompico projects lower on the priority list when they need to be higher. I don't want the remaining two projects to turn out like the Felton Heights tank project, where the community contributed a large share of the cost of the tank in the beginning, but 15 years later, that contribution is now a fraction of the overall cost, and the rest of us have to pick that money up. As it is, we're already short about $2 to $3 million to finish the promised Lompico projects. I understand that the virus and CZU fire recovery affected our district in a significant fashion, but even before those events, it was not clear to me exactly how Lompico was going to get finished. And since I joined this board, I've been consistently asking that these projects get done ASAP, because I believe we want to be known as a good partner when it comes to consolidation, meaning we implement our commitments promptly and meet them fully. Our district promised, and we still need to deliver on the individual service line replacements and the permanent distribution line in the Lompico, which I now believe has been funded. The longer we wait to do these projects, the more it's going to cost and will cost the SLVWD community. I'm hopeful that our current board and future boards will keep their eye on the ball to finish this project as rapidly because it just needs to be done. And so for these reasons, at this point, without any changes, I will vote no on the letter and encourage the grand jury to seek input from all previously and current involved parties as part of their follow-up to produce a comprehensive report.
Director Henry?
Well, there are a couple of things to be done. All the tanks haven't been replaced, but they're scheduled. The last two tanks are scheduled to be replaced by May 10th. The other item, a big item that hasn't been done, is the connection, the intertide between San Lorenzo and Lompico. And I know they want to get that done. Yes, the money has been spent, but there's one thing that people don't know and don't understand. Special districts since 1979 have received money from property tax. Now, I'm not talking about, we're paying $600 a year in Lompico. I'm not talking about that money. It's something you don't even see on your bill. So all special districts get some money. Now, fire districts totally supported by property tax. Now, Ziani Fire, they passed something, and so we are paying more if we're part of Ziani Fire, and we do see that on our tax bill. But in 79, of the Jarvis, Prop 13 bill passed. And so when Lompico merged with SLV, I think we were, Lompico, if I remember right, we were receiving about $70,000 a year from that bit of property tax that was coming to us. And as part of the merger agreement, SLV got our property tax. That, I think it might only be 1%. It's a really small amount. But every year, property values go up. There's only been 2 years, 2008, 2009, that were negative years. And there was no growth. But I predict, just seeing the houses around me that have sold and people moving in and out, that it could easily, and maybe if Stephanie is still listening, maybe she knows how much they're getting, the district's getting from Lompico. But it seems to me it could easily get up to $90,000, $100,000 every year. And that's gonna go on and on and on. The legislature cannot just say, uh-uh, we aren't doing this. So even though we're out of money with this from the $600 that we're paying, we haven't paid it all yet, but it's already been spent. But that money, that 1%, from property tax is going to continue to come to SLV. They're going to continue to get money from us. So I think it's kind of disingenuous to say we're out of money. Yeah, that $600 we're paying every year, and we have still like 5 more or 6 years to pay. That's spent, but I just want people to realize about property tax, and that's going to continue. Okay.
Director Smalley?
Yes, a few questions. On response number one regarding the annual report, I don't see anything in there as to a time frame when that might be completed for the past year. And given that, and given where we are now, halfway through the 2021 budget cycle, is it appropriate to propose we will submit a biannual report for this to address R1?
Could I say something there?
Yes.
Because I'm the liaison and I've been talking to them.
Yes, go ahead.
Okay.
Okay. They're supposed to have the report done by the end of the year. Mm-hmm. That's part of that, what their charter says. But 2020, as everybody keeps bringing up, was a year of COVID and fire. And they didn't get the report done. And they're, as soon as, hopefully, the four people for that board are approved, to, or for that committee, the LADA committee, are approved tonight. And with the help of Stephanie and others, that this will get done as soon as possible, the annual report.
Okay. All right. From reading this and from other sources, I think that the district considers some of these items to be completed. In particular, R3 and a couple of others. If that's the case, if the district does think that, is it appropriate to say that in these IC3 recommendations, so that I expect when we have to go back again to the grand jury with another response a year from now or a year and a half from now, we don't have to reiterate those. And I think, Gina, you could comment on that better than.
Sure, I'll take a shot at that. I guess I'm not sure that whether we say something is completed or not will factor into whether we get further follow-up. I mean, if you look at the, I think we've said in the prior response that certain things were completed. Mm-hmm. And then the request for information that we got requested, it specifically, it didn't request kind of, the specific request we got from the grand jury was to provide documented evidence of follow-through and implementation. And it wasn't limited only to the recommendations that we had previously indicated were ongoing versus completed. So I'm not sure that, I don't have any problem adding that language. I mean, I'm sure you saw in the prior draft response that we had that kind of language in there and we could put it back, but I don't know that it will have much impact in terms of whether we get another one of these in the future.
For not the entire, all of the responses, but specifically R3, R4, and R7 were the ones that it appeared to me as though we provided enough information with this letter, with all of the backups that you've provided. But I don't want it to hold up a submittal by March 11th, if that's an issue. So it's a question, not something that has to be done.
Yeah, and I think that could be added, Director Smalley, if that's the will of the board.
Okay. Okay. My other questions are on the enclosures. I don't see references to enclosures G and H in the text or in your document, in the letter itself.
That is a fair point. And it's one that I thought about in preparing the draft response. Could you say the letters again, Director Smalley?
Gulf and hotel.
Okay, Gulf and hotel. I thought that Gulf had been mentioned.
You may have alluded to it, but in for all of the rest of the enclosures, you reference in parentheses C enclosure F, C enclosure D, I didn't see these two called out.
Okay.
And I think they should be. If you are wanting me to conclude something by including that enclosure as part of the reference material.
Okay, and I believe that could be done.
Okay, I think it's a minor change, but I think it helps the reader then understand what we are trying to convey. And then on enclosure H, hotel, why is that pertinent to this response? Because that Brown Act training was for the board and hasn't been presented to the LADOC committee, or I failed to see the significance of that one.
Sure, and I did go back and forth on that, Director Smalley. And I suppose I may be inserting too much of my recollection of this process into the response. I recall training being an issue with the grand jury. In addition, I believe many committee members attended that Brown Act training, even though it wasn't specifically presented at a committee meeting, but rather to the board. So I believe it did serve a function as committee training.
Okay.
But I guess I was hesitant to spell that out because I'm not certain exactly who was in attendance.
Director Henry, can you answer that question? Director Henry, do you know about the training?
Yes. Everybody was invited. It wasn't just for the board to that
training. Okay.
And it was more than just Brown Act. It was more things than that.
Okay. All right. Thank you then. All right. That's all my questions.
Okay. I guess we'll go out to the public now, if any of them have questions. And I see that Mark Lee does.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, I thought the response looked pretty clear to me. It answered all the questions, so I'm in favor of allowing it to be sent to the grand jury. It looks fine to me.
Anybody else like to make a comment? Tony. Tony Norton.
Okay, sorry, I had to wait for that unmute button to pop up. yes, I'm Tony Norton, and I've been on the LADOC committee since inception. And I just wanted to say that that while it's true, we do have the most important one is the intertie that hasn't been completed. I did send the memo in explaining that the first year and a half after our merger, nothing was accomplished at all. And now, even during the pandemic and the fire, we still had our tanks going in. So we have two Lewis tank and the drone tanks are completely in. They look beautiful. James Furtado took me and the co-chair out on a tour of it last Thursday, and everything looks great. And then the last one will be completed, Caskey, on as Lois said, on May 10th. And I mean, I think that's the most important thing. And I mean, it would be nice if the board would commit to. We in Lompico feel that if the projects, as had been promised by the former district manager, had been jumped on like he promised, he said since we were paying for him, that they would have been a priority, and yet nothing was done. If they had been worked on immediately, then I think they would be done now at a much lower cost, and we would not be out of money. But unfortunately, we are out of money. So it would be nice if the, I mean, we would love to see a, we've heard that you're going, it's going to go in front of the board as the Intertie project comes closer for, to commit to that cost. We would love to hear that you commit to it because that's what was promised to us. If money ran out, the former district manager said in front of all of Lompico at the Ziani Fire Department that it would be at your cost. And so the that's something that is critical. And but I mean, and that's not what I was going to say. This is in response to what Director Folt said. I wanted to say that we are very, everybody is happy that the tanks are in, that and that's the most important thing. And I don't understand the issue about our charter. It is complete. We it was approved by the board. That was I think it was in 2019. It was completed. And as I asked Ms. Nichols to add something about how our committee believes that it's kind of a fluid document, and that as issues come up, we might want to adjust it. But right now, it's complete. So I'm out of time now. So that's all I wanted to say. Thank you very much. I think it looks great too. I vote that you approve it. I mean, that's my personal vote. If I had a vote, that's what I would do. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Tony. It's important to hear your perspective on it. Thank you very much. Anybody else want to say anything? Okay. Well, I guess my response is if Tony's happy with the draft letter, then I'm happy with it. And so I'd like to move that we adopt the draft response to the grand jury with minor edits suggested by Director Smalley, and authorize the board president to sign the response letter on behalf of the board and direct staff to proceed with submitting it.
Second.
Okay. Any more discussion? All right, can we have a vote?
President Mayhood?
Aye.
Vice President Henry?
Aye.
Director Foles?
No.
Director Smalley?
Yes.
And Director Tu is absent. Motion passes.
Okay, and we now go to our last item of unfinished business, which is the approving the minutes for the special board of director meeting on February 2nd. And this arose because Director Foltz took it off of the consent agenda because he wanted to check the recording of the meeting to see if it was captured in the notes. And Jean and I discussed this and realized that we'd actually, that I sort of made a mistake allowing that because technically the minutes are supposed to reflect what happens in the meeting. They are not supposed to reflect what somebody else writes outside of the meeting. And so what should happen is that if anybody wants to make changes to the minutes, they should come to the board meeting ready to suggest what those changes are so that it is recorded on, made, those corrections are made, and it's part of the videotape that we have of the meeting, and then we can all approve that. So with that, what I would just suggest is we allowed Director Foltz to, it was my mistake to allow him to do it, but that we just append his comments on the agenda to the minutes.
Okay, I got an issue here.
Okay.
The board policy manual says minutes are summary minutes. What he is proposing here is not summary minutes. And I've got an issue with that. Either we do summary minutes, or all of us can just write out what we want to say and make sure every word is in the minutes, and it'll take us 3 years to just read the minutes.
I am in agreement, and maybe I didn't state this correctly, that these are summary minutes, and in the future, I won't make the mistake that I made at the last meeting, and that directors will have to state what change they want to the minutes at the time, if they pull it off the consent agenda, and they will have to be cast in such a way that they're a summary minute. So in other words, you can't send in something that's 10 times longer than what was written. Okay, but what I'm saying is I made a mistake, and so for this one time, I'm just suggesting we make an exception that we just append Bob's modifications to the agenda. Go ahead, Holly.
I have a question about the statements that have been read recently. Several directors have read statements, and are they to be included as a written addition to the minutes, or exactly how is that going to be handled?
I agree that it's related, but let's answer this one first, and then we can come back to that. If you don't mind.
You noticed my raised hand sooner than I expected you would. So I apologize.
No, I think we just need to deal with the minutes that we have to vote on right now. And then we can go back to your question, because it's germane.
No, Gail, I think that's a great suggestion. Let's just go with that.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, you're no problem.
Okay. So I'm just making a motion that we adopt the minutes with the appended page by Bob. And Bob is seconding. Okay, any further discussion? If not, we'll take a vote.
President Chair Mayhood, public comments, if any?
Oh gosh, I'm sorry, I forget. All right, any public comments on that? Doesn't look like it. All right, go ahead, Holly.
President Mayhood?
Aye.
Vice President Henry?
No.
Director Falls?
Yes.
Director Smalley?
Yes.
And again, Director Tu is absent, and so motion passes.
I don't know, Gina, whether we can discuss Holly's question. Or not. Is that legal?
I think it's up to you, Chair Mayhood.
Gail, I'd be okay with you taking that offline with Gina and coming back with a suggestion that we would follow going forward.
I think that my feeling, Bob, is I'll just say my own opinion about it. We can just do this quickly. This is not, I asked Holly and she says that nobody else has ever done this. And I know, for example, before I was elected to the board, I used to watch the board meetings and both Lou Ferris and Rick Moran read statements, but they never asked to have them in the in the minutes. And the minutes are supposed to be summary minutes. And if anybody really cares, they can go to the tape. So I think that I don't think it's appropriate to have things appended in that way, because otherwise, as Lois says, everybody could start doing it.
More transparency for people to read information. I don't know, not a bad thing, but
transparency. Give me a break.
No, of course, it's transparency.
Transparency on your part.
Lois, I really have to object to personal attacks. It's okay to disagree. It's okay to not agree with policy positions, but let's try to keep the personal attacks to a minimum, okay?
Oh, yes, sir.
Lois.
Am I out of line here, Gail?
I think that perhaps Director Fultz and I and Gina should discuss this offline, because I don't think we need to come. It's not a burning issue right now.
That's fine.
Be part of the board policy manual.
Or maybe actually that's a really good idea. That's an excellent idea. Why don't we bring it up there? And we're probably bringing back the board policy manual shortly.
Yeah, that works.
Make that a part of it. How's that? That was a good idea, Rick.
Sounds good.
All right. Let's see. Our next thing is we have new business. And we just have one item on it. And Rick, did you want to go ahead and take
it? Yes, item 5A is the committee appointments. It's recommended that the board of directors appoint 4 public members to the LADOC committee, Jimmy Newton, Mary Ann Lababo, Tony Norton, and Norm Hagen, and consider the attached memo from the board president proposing 2 changes to the board committee assignment for 2021. The Lompico Assessment District Oversight Committee consists of up to 5 public members who have a residential mailing address within the Assessment District 2016-1, which is pretty much the Lompico service area. The district posted an advertisement for public members to serve on the 2021 LADOC Committee on January 14th, 2021, with a February 11th deadline for submitting applications. The district received 1 application, which should be attached in your packet, before the deadline. Shortly after the deadline, the district received 3 additional applications. Those are also attached. All 4 applicants meet the requirements to be appointed to the committee. The board policy manual states that committee appointments will be reviewed by the full board at a board of directors meeting in December of each calendar year or as soon thereafter as practical. Public member applications will be reviewed by the full board. Each committee member shall be appointed by a simple majority vote of the board. And the second part of this item is also attached, is a memo from the board president proposing 2 changes to the previously approved 2021 board member committee assignments on the budget and finance and administration committees. These changes require approval by the board to go into effect. And in your packet, you should have a copy of a memo addressed to me from Chair Mahood asking that we place this item on this upcoming agenda. And currently Director Fultz serves on the administration committee and Director Henry serves on the budget and finance committee. I request that these directors switch assignments so that Director Fultz is on the budget and finance committee and Director Henry is on the administration committee. She would remain as the second director on both committees. I have discussed this switch with Director Henry, and she is amenable. Brown Act rules prevented me from discussing this proposed switch with Director Fultz before the board meeting. The Director Fultz states at the board meeting that he is also amenable to this switch. I request that the board vote to approve these revised committee assignments. If Director Fultz does not want to make the switch, then committee assignments then would remain as they are and no action by the board is necessary. Okay. With that, I'll turn it back over to the chair or district council, whichever feels.
What we'll do is we'll just divide these two things.
That's kind of what I thought, yeah.
To vote on. We'll first address the appointing the 4 members to the LADOC committee, and we had 4 applicants and we're basically recommending that we appoint all 4 of them. And is there any discussion of this by the board? Any discussion by people in the audience?
And Chair Mayhood, I just recommend clarifying if you're taking public comments on both pieces, issues.
We're divided it into, okay, so we're only talking now about the appointing 4 new members or appointing the members of the LADOC committee for 2021. And are there any comments from the public? And maybe we should unmute the call-in user to make sure that he or she gets a chance to speak. Colin, user one, did you have anything you wanted to say?
Oh, hi. I'm Christine and Felton. I think I don't really have much to say, but I'm enjoying listening to the whole thing. Thank you.
Thank you, Jamie. Well, we're really glad that you applied. Okay. All right. With that, why don't we, can I just make a, I'll just make a motion. Okay. I'd like to move that the Board of Directors appoint Jamie Newton, Mary LaBamba, Tony Norton, and Norm Hagen as public members of the LADOC committee and consider the attached memo from the board president. Whoop, no, that's it, period. LADOC committee. Okay? Second?
Second.
Okay, thank you. We have a second. So can we have a vote?
Director, excuse me, President Mayhood?
Aye.
Vice President Henry?
Yes.
Director Foles?
Yes.
Director Smalley?
Yes.
And Director Two is absent. Motion passes.
Okay, great. Okay, so for the second half of this, what I'm basically doing is asking for a switch of Director Foles and Director Henry on the two committees that they're on, administration and budget and finance. And as you, some of you know, they served, the last 2 years, they served, both served on both committees. So they're both highly qualified to serve on either committee. And so that, you know, that's, it's fine in that regard. But on the margins, I think that as we watch the discussion of the going out for the loan and other things, we realized that Director Foles had more experience in the sort of finance end of things, which I thought would be helpful to us in terms of thinking about how we, what we might do with that money while we have it in terms of investments and things. And on the other hand, I think Lois has got an awful lot of experience on administering water districts because she used to run one in the Lompico. And I think she has a really good sense of how to do that and has a lot of sympathy and appreciation for the staff in those. So I'm just would like to make that switch, and that's what it's motivated by. But as I said, it's up to Bob because I have a, because of Brown Act, I could only talk to Lois and she was willing to make this switch. Bob, and if he wants to, that's great. If not, then we'll just leave things as they are.
Could I maybe ask for your indulgence, because this was quite a surprise, as you might imagine, given that we had, you know, kind of set things up for the year in January. Could we address this at the next board meeting? I'm this is something I need to ponder on a little bit. There are definitely some, in my mind, policy implications for this, and I haven't given it the kind of thought that it deserves. So with your indulgence and permission, I would like to bring it back on the 18th.
Well, I'd rather just get, go ahead, Lois.
Well, I mean, there are committee meetings that are coming up. So if we put this off, then it's okay. This is March. It'll be April before the switch would really affect committees, I would think.
Yeah, I understand. But I mean, again, this is quite a switch and I need to
ponder. I don't see it as quite a switch, Bob. And I guess my response is if you don't have a clear view on it, then I'll just, you know, I could just take it back. I mean, you had made a strong case for being on budget and finance in January, and I thought it was clear that you wanted to be on there, and maybe I'd made a little bit of a mistake in terms of assigning you and assigning, I should have done it the other way, and I'm trying to correct that, but if you don't feel that that's the case, then I'll just let things.
Well, I mean, if you, I mean, I don't understand the burning urgency here. a couple weeks is not going to make a big difference, and it will give me an opportunity to ponder this a little bit more. That's all I'm asking for, is sort of that kind of courtesy.
Okay. Director Smalley?
Yes. I concur with Director Foltz's request. It's 2 weeks. I think the committees stay with the directors, current directors staying with the committees for that period of time. And we can, okay. Director Foltz elects to after that point.
All right.
Okay.
I think it would be a good idea for you to tell me beforehand so that we can take it off the agenda.
Oh, gee, I'm sorry, didn't think about that, but my apologies.
No, I mean, you don't have to tell me.
I mean, it was, you know, given you had talked to Lois, I was concerned about Brown Act issues.
Well, you can communicate it to Rick. Anyway, okay, let's move on. Actually, that was the last item of new business. So with that, oh wait, we have the consent agenda, I'm sorry. So we're tabling the new business 5A. Do I need to go out to the public if we've tabled in something?
I don't think it's strictly necessary if no action will be taken, but it wouldn't hurt either to find out if somebody was here to comment on that issue.
All right, I'll open up for comment by the public. Okay, seeing none, we'll just go ahead and table it and move on to the consent agenda. Is there anything that anyone would like to pull off the consent agenda for further discussion? Okay, how about any comments from the public on anything on the consent agenda? I don't see anything. Shall we unmute the call-in user just to make sure? Anything from our call-in user? Nope. Okay. Then I think we're barring that. Then we're go to adjournment.
Thank you.
Good night.
Thank you. Good night, everyone.